I believe folks at the Jimmy Carter National Historic Site will be starting off today.
Hi guys, my name is Jacob. I'm the lead ranger here at the Jimmy Carter National Historic Site. We're located in Southwest Georgia in Plains, where Jimmy Carter grew up. So we'll tell you a little bit about his boyhood and the people who influenced his life as a young boy, built his character to become the man that we know as President Carter. And as you can see behind me, we have a picture of the building that we're actually standing in. This is the Plains High School. This is where Jimmy attended school grades 1 through 11. They didn't have kindergarten, they didn't have grade 12 when he's here at school. So we'll take you around some of the classrooms that are now museum exhibits. And we'll tell you about the people that influenced President Carter's life as a young boy. And now I'm going to turn it over to Marley. She's our education specialist here. She'll tell you about our first two people.
Good afternoon and welcome again to the Jimmy Carter National Historic Site. We're so glad you're with us today. My name is Marley Ushery. I'm the education specialist here at the Jimmy Carter National Historic Site. Have the coolest job in the world because I get to tell students all over the United States and the world about the greatest humanitarian, the greatest president of our time, President Jimmy Carter. First of all, I want to tell you about two of the most influential people that from the very start of his life, who had the most influence on him. Come on over and I want to show you some of our displays here that highlight some of these people. The first I want to talk about is his father, Earl Carter. Earl Carter was a brilliant businessman. He taught President Carter the value of stewardship, farming, making money, making your own money, and being a responsible citizen. President Carter took that into his ideals as president with the economy. And he used those lessons that he learned from his father. At a very young age, his father allowed President Carter to work alongside the adults on the farm. And this taught President Carter responsibility. He also taught Jimmy Carter how to have a business as a young child. As a young boy, President Carter would boil peanuts and then bag them up and take them into Plains and sell them. After, he would actually take that money and reinvest it, and he actually would buy bales of cotton, sell that cotton, and then buy rental property as a teenager. So as a very young age, President Carter became a businessman at the encouragement of his father. One of the other things that President Carter did, his father was very influential with his running for political office. His father helping in the community and being a community servant. His father started his political career on the Sumter County School Board. Important to give back to the community and do what you could for others. He was a big proponent of farmers. And he would advocate for farmers during the New Deal, Roosevelt's New Deal. Mr. Earl was actually actually against the New Deal in the beginning because he didn't think it was fair for farmers. And so he would lobby for the farmers during that time. He became a Georgia representative and served until 1953 at his death. So when President Carter, at the time Jimmy Carter came home from the Navy, helped run the family business, he realized what an important impact his father had on the community as a community servant. And that encouraged him to also run for the school board and run for local offices, which then turned in, as we know, he was a state senator, governor, and then ultimately president. So his father had a huge influence on his life. The other person that had such an impact on President Carter's life was his mother, Lillian Carter. Lillian Carter was an advocate for human rights from the very beginning. She was a nurse, and she did not, in a time of during the Depression, in a time of great segregation here in the South, Miss Lillian, as everyone called her, she was a huge advocate for humanity. She did not see skin color. She saw the quality of your character, and she nursed everyone in the community, regardless of color or regardless of ability to pay. This is an example. This was not Miss Logan's nursing uniform, but this uniform was one that just like what she would have worn at Wise Sanitarium here in Plains, Georgia. And because she was a nurse in Plains, Georgia, President Carter, the trivia fact here, was the first president to ever be born in a hospital because his mother actually worked in the hospital at the time. So, President, if you didn't know that, that's a good trivia question. President Carter was the first president to be born in a hospital and not at home. But this would have been similar to your nursing uniform that Ms. Lillian wore. Ms. Lillian later went to India at the age of 68. She took her nursing abilities to continue to serve others. And she actually worked in a leper colony. And she wanted that when she first went to India, they wanted to kind of give her the easier jobs. And she told them, no, I came here to work. I came here to work with the people that need me. So at the age of 68, she traveled to India to work in the Peace Corps. She was always an advocate for human rights. And she was always an advocate for doing what was right. I don't think there's any doubt that this transcended into the ideals of President Carter and what he took to the White House. His land stewardship came from his father's farming and growing up on the farm. His business ability and his economy, trying to make sure that everything was right and saving money came from his father's lessons. And he ultimately won a Nobel Peace Prize because of the ideals instilled in him by his, not just his mother, but mainly his mother, Miss Lillian, who never saw color and taught her children to see people as humans and not as color. And one thing that I wanted to read to you today, in a letter that Miss Lillian wrote home when she was in India, she wrote letters, didn't have internet during that time, so she would write letters home, and which were later composed into a book. But one of her favorite quotes, and one of her, I think, this quote that she wrote to her children, this kind of embodies everything that she stood for. She said, if I had one wish for my children, it would be that each of you would dare to do the things and reach the goals in your own lives that have meaning for you as individuals, doing as much as you can for everybody, but not worrying if you don't please everyone. And I think that that quote embodies what President Carter did also when he served his country. And at 96 years old today, he continues to do just that. He tries to do everything he can for everyone. And his mother and his father were two of the people that instilled that in him. Now, Ranger Jacob is going to tell you about two very important ladies in President Carter's young life that helped shape even more of his ideals.
All right, so if you guys follow me, we'll go into our next group. So, behind me, you now see a fishing pole. It's a bamboo fishing rod that actually belonged to President Carter. And right here is a fishing fly. He actually tied that fly when he was in the White House. So it may seem a bit strange that I'm bringing up one of President Carter's hobbies when I'm talking about people who are influential in developing his character, but the lady who actually taught him to fish, her name was Rachel Clark. And if you could show the image of Rachel Clark on the screen for everyone, I'd appreciate that. So Rachel Clark was the wife of the farm foreman who worked on Jimmy's father's farm growing up there. And what that meant is that her husband, Jack Clark, was in charge of all the workers, and everyone also looked up to Rachel. Now, Rachel, she was Black, like most of the workers on the farm. But as we heard Miss Marley talking about, learning from his mother, Jimmy didn't really see race the way most people here in the South did during that time. He actually regarded Rachel Clark as a second mother. In fact, he even wrote a poem about Rachel. He would say that her brown skin fixed her in our segregated work, yet Rachel had the aura of a queen. Sometimes she'd smile at me and mention fish. Then she and I would leave the farm and walk 6 miles or so to reach the stream she knew. These journeys gave us ample time to talk, or rather, I would listen to her words, as she would think a while and then hold forth about God's holy way, how when we deal with nature, we are stewards of the earth. She'd say that blessings bring on debts to pay, describe the duties of a man and wife, and say the brave and strongest need not to fight. She'd tell of how praying gave her life a lift, and how it made her act and not just talk, like staying up all night with someone sick. It wasn't empty preaching like in church. Sometimes I wasn't glad to reach the creek. So Jimmy continued fishing throughout his life. He thought that it brought him closer, not only in his faith, but also with the outdoors. And I can see that Rachel taught him how important faith and gentleness and dedication and humanitarianism not only was to her, but should be for all humankind. And she also taught him how the earth takes care of us and how we need to take care of the earth. So Jimmy Carter was a huge advocate for the rest of his life for the outdoors. He actually passed a law called ANILCA, which preserved millions of acres in Alaska for our generation and for generations to come after him, to help preserve, protect, and cherish those natural resources that we still have in our country. So if you guys are ready, follow me. We're gonna go into another room and we'll actually tell you a little bit more about one last lady here in the community of Plains that had a huge impact. And as we walk, you're welcome to share that picture on the screen of President Carter fishing. As you can see, he continued to fish throughout his entire life. So as you can see, we're now in a classroom. As I mentioned at the beginning of the program, Jimmy Carter attended school here at Plains High School from grades 1 through grades 11. That's his entire school career here. Now, this school was not normal. It was actually one of the top 3 schools in the state of Georgia. It was called a model school. And the reason why Plains High School in a small town in southwest Georgia became a model school was largely due to the efforts of Miss Julia Coleman. She was a teacher, the principal, and the superintendent here at Plains High School. She won national distinction for her teaching. And Julia Coleman, she was pretty much the favorite teacher of everyone who went to school here at Plains High School. And she was also very invested in her students. She used to keep scrapbooks of a lot of the students and the activities here. And Julia Coleman was way ahead of her time. She instituted programs here during the Great Depression that helped students learn life skills that they carried with them to better themselves at home. She realized that a lot of students weren't really being taught about hygiene or sanitation. She wanted to make sure that people could take care of themselves once they graduated. She also realized that since it was the Depression, a lot of students at home weren't getting hot meals. So if you'd like, come with me. Let's look at one of Ms. Julia's scrapbooks.
So as you can see in the scrapbook, we see 2 pictures. The one here on the bottom, you see some students. They're actually around a water spigot. Miss Julia made sure that all the students would wash their hands before they went to lunch. So that way they could make sure that they were not infecting themselves with germs that they got from the outside world. As we flip through, you see here the students lining up to go upstairs to their lunchroom, ready to get their meal. She taught the students how to cook through home economics. And as you can see, the students also were given little lessons on how to keep themselves healthy and clean. Here you can see one of the cartoons says drink plenty of milk. I'm sure you guys still do that today. If you're in school, eat your fruits and vegetables, exercise in the fresh air, sleep with your window open. How many of you still do that today? And sometimes they even had poems that come with it too. So as you can see, Julia Coleman wanted to make sure that her students were taking care of themselves.
But Julia, she also wanted them to have a full education. She wanted it to be full of arts, literature, classics, music. Jimmy Carter was actually encouraged to read Tolstoy's War and Peace. It's a huge book, very advanced, at the age of 12. So Jimmy Carter got his love of reading and writing from his Julia. And she also used to walk around the halls of the classroom, and she used to tell the students little sayings, little quotes that she wished for all of them and to take into their hearts and actually live out on a daily basis. And you can see that we have a few up here on the chalkboard. So one here is that readers make leaders. I'm sure that you can see how that translated directly with Jimmy Carter. He would generally read about a book a week. Here's another one, always do your best. One of you may grow up to be the president. So you can see there that Julia Coleman was almost prophetic when she said that, because Jimmy Carter tried his best and then became the president of the United States. And because of the huge impact that Julia Coleman had on President Carter when he was here at Plains High School, Julia Coleman was actually the first teacher who was ever quoted during an inaugural address when Jimmy Carter was sworn in as president. And this is the quote, "We must adjust to changing times and still hold to unchanging principles." So you can see that Jimmy developed a love of education. He realized how important reading was. Out of all the presidents, he has written the most books to date. So we're really proud of Julia Coleman and the inspiration and impact that she had on President Carter leaving Plains to go out and explore the rest of the world as he heads off to college. So thank you. If we have any questions about any of the four people we talked about, we can maybe take one or two. But if not, then we'll turn it over to the Presidential Library in Atlanta.
Okay, thank you very much, Jacob and Marl. That was a great presentation. So with us from the Jimmy Carter Presidential Library Museum today is myself, Josh Montanari. I'm the education specialist. We also have Tony Clark, our public affairs specialist. And we also have Carla Ledgerwood, who is our museum registrar. And what we're all going to be doing, we're not on site at our library. We're all working remotely from home, but we all have chosen items in our holdings that are personally meaningful to us that we think demonstrate at least one aspect of the extraordinary life of Jimmy Carter. And we're doing all of this as a reminder in celebration of his 96th birthday. So as far as our order, let's see. Tony, would you like to open it up for us with your presentation?
Certainly, I certainly can. You know, it's interesting, Josh. I was thinking as I was listening to Jacob as he was talking about the classroom and showing pictures of the kids going to school. It reminded me of something that Carter's grandson, Jason, said. He has told students in the past, look at pictures of my granddad as a student, as a child. There's nothing in that that says this person is going to grow up to be president of the United States, a Nobel Peace Prize winner, any of the things that he has accomplished. And Jason was saying that to school kids to say, we all have the opportunity to do the kinds of things President Carter has done over the years. There's nothing that makes him actually stand out. I've been very fortunate over the years to give tours of the museum along with President and Mrs. Carter and hear their stories. And it has given me a sense of kind of why he is the way he is. As you go through and you hear the stories of him growing up in Plains, and that's the sort of thing you can see at the historic site, see at the farmhouse, growing up during segregation, where his dad is a segregationist, his mom is very much the opposite, and how that influenced him. Jack and Rachel Clark influenced him. The Carters were one of two white families in Archery. He saw how people were treated, and I think that set him on his goal for human rights. His mom being a nurse taught him the importance of health care. In fact, if you go to the farm, you can see a table that is like the table they had in their home. And President Carter and his sisters used to call that table Mom, because Lillian Carter would leave notes on it telling them what to do throughout the day, because she was always on the go. She was always needed. And he saw the need for health care, two of the three things he spent most of his life doing. And then when he ran for the state Senate and initially lost in the ballot count because of election fraud, challenged it in court and won and was seated in the state Senate, he saw the importance again of free and fair elections. So those are the sorts of things that really influenced him. But the thing that I think the most is a picture. I used to, in giving a tour, talk to people about his inaugural address as governor. And it's a famous one where he says, "The time for racial discrimination is over." And then I started reading another portion of the speech. And it's a portion that I have come to think is even more important and shows what he is really like. And it says, the test of a government is not how it treats those who have the privileged and the powerful, but how we take care of those who need the help of the government the most. And I have found that is really not only important today, but it's a culmination of everything he's been taught, because he saw the needs. And I'm sorry, there's some folks with blowers just outside here. You probably hear them in the background, but it shows that he learned as a young man growing up during segregation what it's like to have needs and to depend on government and depend on others for help. And I think that quote really encapsulates his feelings. And you see it later on when he gets his Nobel Peace Prize lecture and says, "God gives us the opportunity to do things for others," essentially. And those are things we must do. And so I think by visiting places like the museum and like the historic site, you get a sense of who Jimmy Carter is, why he is the way he is, and the challenge that we all have this opportunity. And that's one of the things I think is so important. Thanks, Josh.
Well, no, thank you so much, Tony. You know, I just had a street sweeper going by my house. I was afraid I was going to have some similar interference there, but it's going by. But yes, thank you so much for those reminders of President Carter's life and for those primary sources that help exemplify the extraordinary quality of life that he's led. Now, our museum registrar, Carla Ledgerwood, will be presenting a primary source that's very near and dear to her heart. She's a big fan of comics. She helped us do an amazing exhibit on the Georgia film industry, much of it having to do with comic book characters, Marvel and et cetera. But she's got a great item to present with us today. So Carla, I'll let you take it away.
Okay, I have some slides to share. get this started. Thank you for your assistance. So I'm Carla Ledgerwood, and I'm the museum registrar, as he said. And basically, I have a really cool job where I get to care for all of the 40,000 objects that we have in the collection. And less than 5% of the collection is actually on display. So we're looking forward to opening back up so we can change out a few objects and show off some things. But one of the things that we have in the collection is actually in the archives. And as Josh said, we uncovered it when we were doing our film exhibit. And we found this wonderful tie to Marvel and also this wonderful program that many people on staff, when we brought it up, they remembered this comic. So depending on your age, you may also remember this comic book. So the program is from the Carter administration, and it was inspired by President Carter and his commitment to energy conservation. So as you know, on August the 4th, 1977, President Carter created the Department of Energy and signed the U.S. Department of Energy Organization Act, partially because America had faced a serious energy crisis in the mid-1970s. So in 1980, the Department of Energy partnered with Marvel Comics and Campbell Soup to reach the youth of America and get them started on the lifelong practice of energy conservation. Okay, next slide, please. So this is an invitation to this special event. And the way it came about, a memo came across Mrs. Carter's desk about a month before that stated Marvel and the Department of Energy wanted to host a kickoff party for this program at the White House just for kids. And it was totally paid for by Marvel and Campbell Soup. It wasn't clear in the memo who turned it down, but luckily Mrs. Carter's secretary brought it to the First Lady's attention, and she thought it was a wonderful idea. She saw this energy program as having the potential to be as big as the Keep America Beautiful campaign. So slide three, please. So 40 years ago on this date, which happened to be President Carter's birthday, Mrs. Carter and Amy hosted Captain America and all the Marvel characters for the Captain America Youth Energy Conservation Program on the South Lawn of the White House. President Carter was busy on the campaign trail in Michigan and Niagara Falls that day, so he did not get to take part in it. But from reading all the memos and the documents that we found, it happened pretty quickly, so I'm sure he was disappointed. Slide four, please. Okay, so the program kickoff party featured all the Marvel costume characters, free food, balloons, free comics, a Polaroid photo station. Marvel comic illustrators were there drawing pictures for kids, and everybody received an energy diploma. Next slide. So Stan Lee, he's in the back wearing the dark blazer and the khaki pants. He was even in attendance for this program, and Mrs. Carter addressed the crowd to introduce the program. Here she is being aggravated by the Green Goblin right before Spider-Man comes in and saves her. Slide six, please. So the comic book that the guests received was also given out to almost every kid in America the following week, with content written by the Department of Energy and provided to Marvel's writers. The 32-page comic is titled The Battle of the Energy Drainers. This is the cover of that one, and the comic is in our collection. Some of our archivists went home and found this comic. One of our archivists that's been here about 30 years actually happens to be a comic book collector, and he had this one. Slide seven, please. So, in the story, Captain America takes a group of kids to a museum and serves as a tour guide. And then they encounter a group of villains known as the Energy Drainers, only to find out that they are the Energy Drainers. Captain America tells the kids that they may be part of the problem now, but they can also be part of the solution. That's a great lesson for all of us. And this is the very first page of the comic when you open it up. Next slide, please. So the Department of Energy also prepared lesson plans for teachers that accompanied the comic books. The program taught 31.5 million Generation Xers ways to save energy. They were taught that closing the refrigerator door quickly to keep in the cold air saved money and energy. Closing the doors in their homes to keep in the heat or air conditioning, not wasting hot water in the bath and encouraging showers, and lowering the window shades could keep your house cool. And it encouraged them to remember to always turn off the lights and appliances when they were not in use. And this page is one where one of the girls is trying to run and get the shades pulled down to save some energy. Slide 9, please. So the comics were sent to over 80,000 schools, grades kindergarten through 8th grade. Public service announcements featuring Captain America in a cartoon were sent to 750 television stations across the nation and were played during youth viewing time like the Saturday morning cartoons. The audio was sent to over 5,000 radio stations across the U.S., and the public service announcements were also played in movie theaters. So this is from the event. You see Mrs. Carter with Spider-Woman and Spider-Man, Amy, and one of Amy's friends. It's a great shot of the White House. Slide 10, please. So completely paid for by Marvel and Campbell Soup, the program had a price tag of more than $500,000. It was the largest private sector and government partnership to date. And here's a bit of trivia for any Star Trek The Next Generation fans. That day at the White House, Captain America was played by none other than Jonathan Frakes. You may know him as First Officer Riker from the series, who later became Captain Riker. That picture is kind of small, but he has that nice little superhero chin. Next slide, please. This is an item from the museum collection. Stan Lee left this personalized poster for the president, which shows the first family standing with Captain America. It says, "Keep it up, America, keep saving energy." He inscribed it at the bottom, "All the best wishes from the Marvel Entertainment Group, Stan Lee, Excelsior," and dated it 10/1/1980. We had this in the collection for years and always thought it was just a birthday gift to President Carter because of the date. And not until we were doing research for the film exhibit did we uncover this program and realize when Stan Lee had made this for President Carter. And we also sent all the photos that we found to Marvel when we discovered them in the collection. Next slide. So Marvel sent the photos to Stan Lee, and he loved them, and he posted them on his Instagram account with a video of himself reminiscing about the event that day with Mrs. Carter and Amy. And he vividly remembered the Green Goblin aggravating Amy, and he said he warned him the Secret Service would get him if he didn't cool it. And as you can see here, he kept picking Amy up and trying to run off with her. Okay, next slide, please. So one of another primary source that you can search is the Carter Daily Diary on our library website. And I checked out the entry for October 1st, 1980, just to see where President Carter was during this event, what he was doing. And this is what I found. So he had spent the day in Michigan and then Niagara Falls before returning to the White House. So he got to the White House about 9 o'clock that night and was greeted and surprised by a large group, which included Mrs. Carter, Amy, his sister Ruth, Amy's friend Cricket, the Casteliers Choral Group, the White House staff, the DNC staff, and the Carter Mondale Presidential Committee staff, all who sang happy birthday to him. And this is the cake that was presented to President Carter earlier that day by the United Auto Workers Local 900 in Detroit. So we just want to say happy birthday to President Carter from the library. And that's it.
Hey, thank you so much. Great presentation. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get my PowerPoint going here. Okay. All right. So again, we're talking about the extraordinary life of Jimmy Carter. I guess we want to ask ourselves, what is the secret to having an extraordinary life? And throughout his life, President Carter has found himself in extraordinary circumstances, faced with extraordinary opportunities, many of which were brought about by the American presidency. The picture we see there with Deng Xiaoping, Carter has said was perhaps the greatest accomplishment of his presidency, and that would be the normalization of relations with China, something he has said was made possible by the work of his predecessors. But this was just something he said was the greatest accomplishment as president. And we all know, I think Jimmy Carter left the White House at a relatively young age, so he does have much more in his life outside his time in the White House. Well, running for President Carter had some extraordinary supporters to begin with. As governor of Georgia, he had strengthened copyright laws for performing artists that made a few friends like the Allman Brothers, Willie Nelson, later on Bob Dylan. He quotes Bob Dylan at the Democratic National Convention in 1976. We have some cool items in the National Archives catalog, like the autographed picture from Greg Allman, which reads, "Governor Jimmy Carter, best of luck. Our country needs you. Love, Greg Allman." Also, a concert poster that you see there in the middle of the screen. He also had an extraordinary mother in his corner. We've had some folks talk about Miss Lillian today, that she gives birth to young Jimmy while volunteering as a nurse at a sanitarium in Plains. She joins the Peace Corps at the age of 68. And again, President Carter leaves the White House in his 50s, relatively young for someone leaving that position. And I think he looked at his mother seeing her involvement at an older age. And why should that stop him from doing more with his life? He was in an extraordinary election in 1976 against Gerald Ford. A very rare election where an incumbent running for an election, not re-election, was his opponent. He was appointed vice president following the resignation of Vice President Spiro Agnew. And then once Nixon resigns, Gerald Ford takes the reins of the White House. You can read more about that in the 25th Amendment of the Constitution. We have a link to that. Jimmy Carter had rock stars in his corner. Gerald Ford had the Fonz. We can see a great item in the National Archives catalog of a campaign pin or button from the Ford campaign there. And there's a great document I'm also linked to here where Jimmy Carter remembers Gerald Ford after his passing. And much of it, of that document, President Carter talks about the things these two presidents of opposing political parties accomplished together. So it's very poignant to read. I think the president had extraordinary courage coming into the White House. Carla had just presented a comic book that was done to help promote the establishment of the Department of Energy. Well, not even 2 weeks into his term as president, President Carter has a televised address to the nation about the energy crisis. And I think it's extremely courageous and bold to ask the American public, this is muscle car loving, warm and toasty at night American public, turn down your thermostats, put on a sweater, like the exact sweater we're seeing here that he's wore in that speech. You can see that sweater on display in the Jimmy Carter Presidential Library and Museum once we've reopened. But I think that's a big step that he took at that point in history when the environmental movement, despite the fact of a lot of legislation being passed, leading up to his presidency to protect the environment, didn't quite hit home for a lot of Americans yet. And this was really getting personal at this point. But that is what I think a president has to do sometimes, is tell people the things they need to hear, not just the things they want to hear. He had many extraordinary opportunities during his presidency. Maybe few as notable as the Camp David Peace Accords. President Carter brings leaders of Egypt and Israel to the United States for a summit in September of 1978. They think it will just be a weekend. It turns into almost 2 weeks. And it is literally the personal diplomacy of this man occupying the White House that the Constitution puts in this position to negotiate agreements with other leaders. It's his brand of personal diplomacy that saves the Camp David Peace Accords. In fact, this photograph from the National Archives catalog captures the moment this summit was saved when President Carter personalized photographs for Menachem Begin's 8 grandchildren. Carter gets the name of each of those grandchildren and writes a note on these photographs to Prime Minister Begin, who after viewing them literally says, okay, let's give this another try. And they go on to agree to the framework for peace in the Middle East. And a few months later in 79, in March, they sign the conclusion of that agreement, which has held for 40 years between Israel and Egypt. They have not been at war since then, but would Gerald Ford have done something as personal? Would Gerald Ford even have these men at Camp David? Maybe, maybe not. But this Jimmy Carter seemed to be the man for the time and place to make this a success. So that's another extraordinary example. Something I like to quote when I've been able to give tours in our museum here in Atlanta about a very significant portion of our museum exhibits is dedicated to Jimmy Carter's post-presidency and his work with the Carter Center. And I think it's a great example that just because you are not the president at the White House anymore, that does not mean you can't still be a leader. And Jimmy Carter's dedication to human rights and diplomacy shows. In 2002, he travels to Cuba to meet with none other than Fidel Castro to discuss human rights and relations between the United States and Cuba. This is a man he's meeting with who, while he was in office, was his de facto sworn enemy. Someone our nation did not have diplomatic relations with, like we did with China. Nonetheless, Carter goes. But what I really love about that is that these leaders found common ground. And for me, it's meaningful because it's in our nation's national pastime, baseball. Carter attended the Cuban All-Star game with Castro. He had a jersey made for him. He chose number 44, his favorite player, Hank Aaron's number, someone who he had was able to visit him in the White House when that home run record was broke. But he throws out that first pitch, and the baseball you see there is on display in the Carter Museum here in Atlanta, and it has the signature of Fidel Castro and Jimmy Carter. So the dictator of Cuba and the former president of the United States together on a baseball. So I think that should signify to everyone that there's always common ground to be found with your adversaries. In case anyone's wondering, the Braves are up 1-0 in their playoff game right now. there's a case of extraordinary redemption. I think a lot of kids would dream of this opportunity. Here we see Jimmy Carter's 6th grade report card, also on display in our museum. A whole lot of A's on that report card. Very consistent in just about everything except music. You see a B in there, and then we see a C. You might also note below that you see the subject of teeth. Carter got consistent OKs in teeth. I think that worked out in his presidential campaigns. But also in our museum is one of 3 Grammy Awards won by the 39th president for Best Spoken Word Album. And this is an honor he shares with Presidents Clinton and Obama in that same category. But I think that's a pretty great example of redemption. C's in music to a Grammy. Or 3. Maybe his extraordinary life was made possible by his extraordinary partner, Rosalynn Carter. They are the longest married presidential couple at 74 years. Little interesting note, they were married the day after President George W. Bush was born in 1946. I had a privilege to be in an audience with Mrs. Carter a little over a year ago. I asked her what the secret was. She said, getting away from each other. So it seems to have worked well for them. She has been a champion of mental health awareness since serving as First Lady of Georgia, something that has continued at the Carter Library, Carter Center today. And there's a link. You click on mental health in the slide, that will take you to the Carter Center's mental health program page. She regularly attended cabinet meetings in the Carter administration. Carla mentioned the President's Daily Diary. That's a resource available on our website under our research tab. You can see and verify in those diaries, Rosalynn Carter is at meetings with the Secretary of State, the Vice President, Secretary of Treasury, you name it. She is there. And I think it's that exposure that allows her to be a trusted confidant of President Carter when he's in office. And she was also a very active supporter of the Equal Rights Amendment, which is still a debate in our nation today. So a very active First Lady, a very dedicated partner. Maybe that's the secret to this extraordinary life President Carter has. If I have to boil it down, I think it might be President Carter's extraordinary faith and service that has put him in the position to have this extraordinary life. And it's a very poignant quote that I've chosen there that I think sums up the formula to live a life similar to that of President Carter's. I think selflessness and service will put you in those circumstances and opportunities to have an extraordinary life. And the picture there I chose, I really like that picture. Jimmy Carter was traveling to New York for a visit to the United Nations. At that time, you may or may not know, the Bronx were on fire, basically the whole city, for the better part of a decade. That had been the result of realigned public resources for firefighting, which basically negatively affected communities of color and poor communities. President Carter goes to visit the Bronx there to interact with residents. Following that visit, he then went to the United Nations and signed its Covenant on Human Rights. You can view that in the President's Daily Diary for October 5th, 1977. So I think we have this amazing example of a former president, 96 years old today, has lived through so much, done so many things that are benchmarks in the history of our nation, and I'm just so happy that the Jimmy Carter Presidential Library and the Jimmy Carter National Historic Site could come together today to try to bring some semblance to this life of this amazing person and to show our personal relevance and things that are meaningful to us. And I hope that these primary sources have resonated with members of our audience today. Whether student or teachers, we have a lot of great tools at your disposal between the National Park Service and the National Archives to learn about our 39th president, to see how it fits into American civics, and just to see how he has been relevant to all of our lives. So thank you so very much for giving us this opportunity today. And I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing my screen. And we can now, I think we have some time for questions if anybody has those. Well, if we don't have any questions coming in, are there any other panelists that had any other thoughts they wanted to add?
This is Jacob back at the high school here. I just wanted to add, when we talk about Jimmy Carter and his environmental stewardship too, he was a huge advocate for green energy as well. He grew up on a farm that had indoor plumbing for the first time because of a windmill. Most of his time growing up, they used mules instead of a gasoline tractor. In fact, he was the first president to put solar panels on the White House
And then they were taken off when the next president, Ronald Reagan, came into office. Even today, he has a solar farm in Plains that powers about half the power needs of the entire town. So he not only talks the talk, but he walks the walk. So looking towards the future, he realizes that energy needs to be a diverse program where we rely on multiple different sources, not just one or two.
And to add to that, the Presidential Library here in Atlanta also has solar panels on its roof. And our exhibit has one of the original solar panels that were on the roof of the White House during Carter's term.
It looks like we do have one question here. Barbara asked, are there any significant accomplishments his siblings did throughout their life?
President Carter had three siblings, his sister Ruth, his sister Gloria, and his younger brother Billy. They were all accomplished in their life for sure. His sister Ruth was an evangelist in North Carolina, and she had a great many followers, and she was revered in her community. For his sister Gloria is most famous for riding motorcycles. She was a member of a Harley group that rode motorcycles, but she was a homemaker. And she was a farmer. Her husband, Walter, was a farmer. So she worked very hard in her community and worked on the farm and was a homemaker. And she was also instrumental in helping his mother, Miss Lillian, write her book, Letters from Home, from India. And she was an advocate in her community. His younger brother, Billy, was very famous for his antics during the campaign and afterwards. But he was also a very studious man. He ran the warehouse, the farming business, when President Carter was on the campaign trail, and when he was president, his brother Billy picked up the slack there, and he ran the farming business and the farming warehouse. And many people think of Billy Carter as, drinking Billy beer and drinking and that sort of thing. But he was much more than that. And he was actually, he lived his life to the fullest. He would read books every day. He would read 2 and 3 books a week. He read newspapers. He was very accomplished. His mother, Miss Lillian, oftentimes said that he was the smartest of her 4 children. And then in President Carter, and they would laugh about that and joke about that. One of my favorite stories is after the inauguration in Washington, a reporter came up to Miss Lillian and said, "I know you were so proud of your son today." And she said, "Which one?" And President Carter has said that with that he didn't really like that very much, but Billy Carter's family sure did. So, all of his siblings were very accomplished and very loved in their community.
And I also saw that we had a question about where President Carter lives today. Since 1953, when his father passed away, President Carter and Rosalynn Carter have both called Plains their home. So that was about a little more than 20 years before he becomes president. He has been living in Plains. And when he retires from the presidency, he gets on board Marine One, that's the presidential helicopter, and he lands right here, I think, on a softball field. Mm-hmm. And he's welcomed home by all the residents here with what they call the largest covered dish dinner in the world. And they moved into a modest one-story ranch house that they purchased in the 1960s, and they've been there ever since. So that's where they still live today.
And Jacob and Marl, correct me if I'm wrong, once President and Mrs. Carter have both passed, does the residence not then get folded into the National Historic Site?
So the residence today is already part of the National Park Service.
Okay.
In fact, we have staff over there right now who take care of the Carter's Garden. But
it's obviously closed to the public because Secret Service don't want just anyone walking around on the grounds. But generally what happens when Park Service owns a home that the president is living in, when the home is no longer used, whether that living president decides to move out or the president passes, that home is most often opened as a museum to the public, but sometimes it takes a little bit of time to happen. One of the more recent ones that had an arrangement like that was the Eisenhower National Historic Site in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. So most people don't realize that President Eisenhower retired to Pennsylvania on the battlefield because of the Civil War, and his home today is open as a museum. You can go tour it through the National Park Service.
And his home here in Plains will become a presidential burial site when President and Mrs. Carter pass. They will actually, on the grounds of where their home is now, that will actually become their burial site in here in Plains.
Mm-hmm. Very good. And that note on the Eisenhower site, I've been there myself. And that site's very unique, and the Carter will probably be similar in that, because of it, how recent it is, an overwhelming amount of the artifacts and objects will be original. I think at the Eisenhower site, it's about 95% of what you see is authentic Ike.
Yeah, and this is kind of a note to a lot of the students who may have future political aspirations too. If you have, you know, objects from your childhood, don't get rid of them. Because in our park, we actually have Jimmy Carter's boyhood home as well, next to a demonstration farm on the original land. And when people come into that house, all the furniture, all the stuff inside is not original, because when the Carter family, you know, continued to live before they knew that President Carter was gonna be the president someday, I mean, just like any other family, you replace your furniture, you might sell some things, you know, it's kind of a lesson that if you think you're going to be famous, hold on to things, because people will appreciate it.
And Jacob, can't you at this point drive by and see the public housing the Carters lived in when they first moved back to Plains?
You can. Marley, do you want to talk about that?
Yes, they actually lived in, it is a small public housing apartment down the road, actually about a couple of blocks from where we sit here. When they moved back to run the family business, they did not have enough money. They were actually on public assistance for a little while. They came in and they had very little money. They were starting the business back up again, and they had a hard time. You know, they lived in this public housing, which is still there today. Now, the unit that they actually lived in is not, there is no one living in that right now, but the rest of the public housing units, that they do have tenants now. And you can ride by and see that. And then they built their home, as Jacob was saying, I think it was 1962, they actually built the home that they still live in today, that's just right down the road from that public housing. So they came a long way when they came back home, but he came home to take care of his family and to run the business, because his younger brother Billy, he was too young to he was just a young teenager when his father died, and so that is why then Jimmy Carter left the Navy to come home to help run the family business, because Miss Lillian could not do that on her own.
Okay. I don't think we have any more questions, so I just want to thank you, all of our presenters. You all, we really appreciate your time today and all the knowledge you've shared with us. And thank you everybody who attended. We hope you enjoyed the presentation today, and hopefully you'll look out for some of our future presentations as well. Everyone, have a great day.
Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you. Yep. Happy birthday, President Carter.
Thanks. Happy birthday.
Thanks. Bye.